In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. In the last chapters, Saint Paul was trying to protect the Christian from Jewish origin, from apostasy, returning back to Judaism. That's why he started to do a comparison between Christ and the angels. Why the angels? Because the law was given to Moses by the angels. And then he made a comparison between Christ and Moses. And Moses was considered a great prophet by the Jews. And also he compared between Joshua, who led them to the promised land, and the Lord Jesus Christ, when he said in chapter 4, verse 8, "For if Joshua had given them rest, then he would not afterward have spoken of another day." So even this rest of the promised land was a symbol for the rest of eternal life. That's why he said, if Joshua gave them rest, he wouldn't afterward have spoken of another day. And while he was comparing the Lord Jesus Christ with Moses, with the angels, with Joshua, he spoke about the Lord Jesus Christ as a high priest. And he mentioned two qualifications for the high priest, or characteristics of the high priest. He has to be faithful and he has to be merciful. Faithful and compassionate. Actually, starting from chapter 5 to chapter 10, chapter 5 we will study today. From chapter 5 to chapter 10, St. Paul starts to make two contrasts. One between Christ as the greatest high priest and between the high priests of the Jews. And also another contrast between their sacrifices, the ritual animal sacrifice of the Old Testament that was offered by the high priests of the Jews or Israel, and the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ. So actually from chapter 5 to chapter 10, St. Paul will elaborate about the role of Christ as the ultimate high priest. And here just it's interesting to observe and to notice that the Lord Jesus Christ was the high priest, was the sacrifice because he offered himself. And also, as St. Cyril said, he was also the altar. So he is the high priest, the sacrifice, and the altar. We'll elaborate more about this. In chapter 5, from verse 1 to verse 4, St. Paul mentioned some qualifications of the high priest in general. He mentioned 6 qualifications for the high priest. Let us read first these 4 verses and we'll try to analyze these qualifications of the high priest. St. Paul said, "For every high priest taken from among men is appointed for men in things pertaining to God, that he may offer both gifts and sacrifices for sins. He can have compassion on those who are ignorant and going astray, since he himself is also subject to weakness. Because of this, he is required, as for the people, so also for himself, to offer sacrifices for sins. But no man takes this honor to himself, but he who is called by God, just as Aaron was. In these four verses, he spoke about six qualifications for the high priest. The first qualification, he said the high priest should be taken from among men, selected from among men, for every high priest taken from among men. And he will explain later why. Because when he is taken from among men, he will be compassionate high priest. Why? Because he himself also is surrounded by weakness. That's why the priest was taken from among men, in order to be able to identify himself with his people. But there is one drawback for being selected from among men. What is this drawback? That he also is surrounded by weakness. That's why he has to offer sacrifices for himself as he offers sacrifices for the people, because he is selected among men. And then when St. Paul will compare between Christ as the ultimate high priest and the Levites high priest, he will explain how Christ doesn't have to offer sacrifices, because he is not only son of man, but he also son of God. That's why he is without blemish, and he doesn't need to offer sacrifices for himself. So the first requirement, he has to be selected from among men. Why? In order to be compassionate. Number two, he is appointed to represent men in matters pertaining to God. As he said, is appointed for men in things pertaining to God. As I explained before, the main function of the high priest is to intercede on behalf of his people, to stand before God offering sacrifices on behalf of his people. That's why you have to be faithful in order to be accepted by God, and has to be compassionate and merciful in order to intercede on behalf of his people. And Samuel, by the way, Samuel, he was not only a prophet, but Samuel, he was also a priest, understood his function as a priest. And he said, how can I sin before God and stop praying for you? He understood his role and his function as a priest. So as a priest, it will be a sin for him if he ceased to pray for his people, because that is the main function of the priest. And as I told you before, the difference between a prophet and a priest. Prophet hears from God and convey the message to the people. That's the role of prophet. Hear from God and say to the people, God said so and so. But the priest hears from the people and presents their supplication before God. That's why St. Paul said he is appointed for men on behalf of men in things pertaining to God, in order to present their supplication, their prayers, their requests, and in order to intercede for their weaknesses in front of the throne of God. The third function of the high priest, he is appointed also to offer gifts and sacrifices for the people. As he said, that he may, in verse 1, that he may offer both gifts and sacrifices for sin. When you study the sacrifices in the book of Leviticus, you will find the word sacrifice means bloody offering. There is shedding of blood, like the burnt offering, sacrifice, like the peace offering, like the sin offering, like the trespass offering. But there is another offering that doesn't have a blood. There is no shedding of blood. Like what? Like the grain offering in Leviticus chapter 2. So when he said to offer both gifts and sacrifices, the word gifts refer to the non-bloody offering. And the word sacrifices refers to the bloody sacrifices. So that's why he said he may offer both gifts and sacrifices for sins. So number one, he is selected from among men. Number two, he is appointed to represent men in matters pertaining to God. Number three, he is appointed to offer gifts and sacrifices before God, for sins. Number four, he is able to deal gently. He is able to deal with compassion. Why? Because he himself is surrounded by weakness. He is a human being. He was selected from among men. That's why he had compassion. He has compassion on the people. Verse 2, he can have compassion on those who are ignorant and going astray. Why? Since he himself is also subject to weakness. Since he himself is also subject to weakness. And that's why when we speak about the incarnation of Christ, it was a must. In order for Christ to offer sacrifices on our behalf, he has to be a son of man. He has to incarnate. He has to be from among us in order to be compassionate for us. As he said in the last chapter, chapter 4, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. That's why the incarnation for the Son of God was a must. He had to be a son of man in order to represent us before God. But he said here, he can have compassion on those who are ignorant and going astray. Those who are ignorant and going astray. Actually, in this verse, St. Paul is saying, this compassion is directed toward those who sin out of ignorance or because they went astray. In order to understand this, let us read from the book of Numbers, chapter 15, from verse 27 to 31. In Numbers 15 from 27 to 31, there is differentiation between those who sin unintentionally by error or by ignorance and those who sin because of their arrogance, because of their pride, and because they are acting against God and resisting God. In verse 27, and if a person sins unintentionally, then he shall bring a female goat in its first year as a sin offering. So the priest shall make atonement for the person who sins unintentionally. When he sins unintentionally before the Lord to make atonement for him, and it shall be forgiven him. You shall have one law for him who sins unintentionally. For him who is native born among the children of Israel, and for the stranger who dwells among men. But in verse 30, now he is differentiating. But the person who does anything presumptuously, whether he is native born or a stranger, that one brings reproach on the Lord, and he shall be cut off from among his people, because he has despised the word of the Lord and has broken his commandment. That person shall be completely cut off his guilt. He shall be completely cut off. His guilt shall be upon him. So it is clear in this passage how the book of Numbers differentiate between the people who sin out of error, out of ignorance, out of weakness, and those who sin out of arrogance, out of pride, because they are resisting the Holy Spirit and resisting the work of God in their hearts. That's why St. Paul, when he spoke about the qualification of the high priest, he said he can have compassion on those who are ignorant and going astray. Those who are ignorant and going astray. And in the Gregorian liturgy, actually, we say, as a true light, you have shone upon the ignorant and the lost. The ignorant and those who are going astray. And I think in Luke chapter 15, when the Lord spoke about the lost coin, the lost sheep, and also the prodigal son, we notice that in the lost coin and in the lost sheep, the woman searched for the lost coin, and the shepherd went to search for the lost sheep. Why? Because the lost coin and the lost sheep represent those who went astray or were lost because of ignorance or going astray, error. But the prodigal son, the father didn't go and search for him. He waited until he returned back. And when he returned back, he accepted him. Because he went out of arrogance. He thought that he can manage his life better away from his father's house. So again, what are the qualifications? Number one, he has to be selected from among men. Number two, he is appointed to represent men in matters related to God. Number three, he is appointed to offer gifts and sacrifices for sin. Number four, he is able to deal gently because he himself subject to weakness. Number five, has to offer sacrifices for his own sins as well as for those of the people. As I told you, being selected from among men, being surrounded by weakness, so he is also sinful. That's why he has to offer sacrifices for himself as well as for the people. Verse 3, because of this, he is required as for the people, so also for himself to offer sacrifices for sin. And the last requirement or qualification of the high priest, he has to be called and appointed by God. He has to be called and appointed by God. As is mentioned in verse 4, and no man takes this honor to himself, but he who is called by God, just as Aaron was. And St. Paul here was referring to a very famous story when Korah and Abiram, they want to take the priesthood for themselves without being called by God. And what happened to them? The earth opened its mouth and swallowed them. So when St. Paul was saying, no man takes his honor to himself, but he who is called by God, just as Aaron was, he was referring to this story. And in the Gospel of St. John, the Lord said to the disciples, to the 12, you didn't choose me, but I chose you and appointed you. So it's clear here, the priesthood is a calling, is appointment by God. These are the six qualifications for the high priesthood to be selected from among men, to be appointed to represent men in matters pertaining to God, to be appointed to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal gently because he himself is subject to weakness. He has to offer sacrifices for his own sins as well as those for the people. And also, he must to be called and appointed by God himself. Now, St. Paul start to compare between the priesthood of Christ, the high priesthood of Christ, and the high priesthood of the Levites, the children or sons of Aaron. But just in order to do this comparison well, I will go to chapter 4, verse 14. The first difference between Christ as the high priest and Aaron as the high priest, we read it in chapter 4, verse 14. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. This is the first comparison. Aaron, as a high priest, he goes through what? Through a veil, man-made curtain, in order to enter what? In order to enter the Holy of the Holies. But Christ didn't go through man-made veil, but he went through heaven. Not in order to enter into man-made tabernacle or temple, but in order to enter through the heaven of heavens. So this is the first difference between Christ as a great high priest and Aaron also as a high priest. Christ also, as I told you, he became man, was incarnate and became man in order to identify himself for us and to sympathize with us. So that is the, one of the six qualifications. He was Son of Man in order to be compassionate, in order to sympathize with our weakness. Then in verse 5 and 6, chapter 5, verse 5 and 6, St. Paul is saying that Christ also is appointed by God. As the high priest is appointed by God, so Christ also was appointed by God. In verse 5, so also Christ did not glorify himself to become high priest. He did not glorify himself to become high priest. But it was he who said to him, he refers to whom? To the Father. Said to him, refers to Son, Jesus Christ. So it was he, it was the Father who appointed the Son as a great high priest. When this appointment happened, when he told him, you are my son, today I have begotten you. And also, he says in another place, you are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. So St. Paul is saying that this hypostasis that the Father addressed him and told him, you are my son, today I have begotten you, this hypostasis was also appointed to be a priest, but not after the order of Aaron, but after the order of Melchizedek. That's why he said in another place, you are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. So, Christ, he is compassionate because he became Son of Man. But also he is the Son of God and was appointed by God to be a great high priest. In verse 7, St. Paul elaborates more about how he was tempted and why he can sympathize with our weaknesses. In verse 7 he said, who in the days of his flesh, in the days of his incarnation, when he became man, when he took flesh and became man, when he had offered up prayer and supplication with vehement cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death and was heard because of his godly fear. So St. Paul in verse 7 is saying that Christ, by experiencing the suffering, agony, and temptation of man, he is also qualified to be a perfect representative to us. He experienced our suffering. He experienced our agony. He experienced our temptation. That's why he is qualified to be a perfect representative for us. Who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplication with vehement cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death. I think St. Paul was referring here to what? To his prayers in Gethsemane. In Gethsemane. If we read the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 22, verse 42 to 44. Luke 22 from verse 42 to 44, saying, that's Christ was saying, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. That's why during the Holy Passion Week we say, thine is the power, glory, majesty, as if we are participating with this angel who is strengthening him by telling the Lord Jesus Christ, for thine is the power, the strength, the glory, the majesty forever. Amen. And being in agony, verse 44, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. St. Luke, as a physician, he explained the agony of the Lord in very, very detailed and expressive way. So St. Paul was referring to his prayer in Gethsemane when he said, who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayer and supplication with vehement cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death and was heard because of his godly fear. What does it mean? He was able, offered prayer to him who was able to save him from death and was heard because of his godly fear. Many people may say, but God didn't save him from the cross. He died on the cross. How we understand this verse when he said, was heard because of his godly fear? Actually, the Lord Jesus Christ, when he prayed for in Gethsemane, he didn't pray that he will not die on the cross. Or he wouldn't suffer on the cross. Because he made it very clear. And he said, for this hour I have come. So he came to die on the cross. But what does it mean? Actually, he didn't say, I don't want to drink this cup. If you read carefully verse 42, he said, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. So he is saying to the Father, if it is your will, and you want to do this,
and you see it is better to take this cup from me, then I know that you are able to do it. That's why St. Paul said he offered prayer to him who is able to save from death. So here St. Paul is emphasizing the fact that Christ didn't doubt at all that the Father was not able to save him from the death. That's why he said, if it is your will, I know for sure that you can save me from this. You can take away this cup from me. And as he said to Peter when he used the sword, he told him, return the sword to its place. If I want, I will ask the Father and he will send me 12 myriads of angels to deliver me. So he prayed and he never had doubt that the Father can save him. But he said what? But nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. This doesn't mean there is a conflict or a contradiction between the will of the Son and the will of the Father, because the Son and Father are one. But this shows total submission, total surrender, total obedience to the will of the Father. I came here to earth in order to do your will. So my will is your will. And when St. Paul said, and he was heard because this prayer, it is not my will, but your will, this prayer was heard by the Father. And the will of the Father was fulfilled. And actually, Christ was saved from death. How? By his resurrection. As we chant in Christus Anesti, by his death, he trampled upon death. So, in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayer and supplications, with vehement cries and tears to him, who was able to save him from death, this shows us that Christ didn't doubt at all that the Father is able to save him. And was heard this prayer, it is not my will, but your will be done. This prayer was heard. Because of his godly fear. What's his godly fear? His complete obedience to the will of God. His complete submission to the will of the Father. And here St. Paul is sending message to the Hebrews. He told them, now you suffer, and there is pressure on you to return back to Judaism. I want you to do as Christ. As Christ surrendered his will completely to the will of the Father, so also, as you say in the Lord's Prayer, thy will be done, you need to surrender completely your will to the Father. And don't doubt that the Father can save you from these sufferings and from this persecution. Sometimes when the church suffers or is persecuted, we say, where is you, God? Where are you, God? Why you don't attend to our prayers? No, actually God is able to save us from every persecution. But if he allowed the church to suffer, this is for our own glory. Because if we suffer with him, we'll be glorified with him. And St. Paul started to elaborate more how suffering is the way, is the royal way to glory. He said in verse 8, though he was a son, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. He was a son, and the son not by adoption, but by nature, light of light, true God of true God. But although he is a son, but he submitted his will completely to the will of the Father. Although he was a son, he accepted to suffer. That's why we, if we are his children, also we should accept the persecution and the suffering. We should carry our cross and follow our Lord Jesus Christ. Yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. The word learned here means he fulfilled his obedience. He practiced the obedience. He left the obedience when he accepted the suffering, when he accepted to drink from the cup, when he fulfilled the will of the Father. So his obedience became perfect when he accepted the suffering and submitted his will to the will of the Father. And having been perfected, as I explained in chapter 2, this doesn't mean that Christ was imperfect and then he have been perfected. Perfected here means fulfilled. When he finished his mission, when he finished, as he said on the cross, it's finished. When he finished his mission, his ministry, his crucifixion, the goal for which he was incarnated, having been perfected, he become the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him. So, as he obeyed the Father, if we obey him, he will be the author. The author means the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. So, St. Paul, when he reflected about the qualification of Christ in the priesthood, he said in verse 5 and 6, he is appointed by God to be a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Number 2, by experiencing sufferings, agony, and temptation of man, he is qualified to be our perfect representative. Number 3, he became a source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. As the high priest is a source of salvation in a symbolic way, when he offers sacrifices, when he offers gifts on behalf of his people, and their sins are forgiven, Christ also is a source of salvation to those who obey him. And finally, in verse 10, he said, he is called by God as a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. And he will elaborate more about this in chapter 7. So I will keep about the order of Melchizedek, the priesthood according to the order of Melchizedek, to chapter 7. But St. Paul, here he is emphasizing that Christ did not come a high priest after the order of Levi, but after the order of Melchizedek. But what is the theme that St. Paul wants to establish here in these verses? The message he wants to tell us that as Christ fulfilled his obedience through suffering, and this led to finish his or to accomplish his mission and his ministry, in the same way, how do we accomplish our mission, our goal? We are created by him and for him. So how we become perfect? In order to become perfect, we have to obey through suffering, through submitting our will to the will of God. When we do this, then we will become perfect as Christ is perfect. Then starting from, verse 11, he gives them the third warning. As I told you in the letter of Hebrew, how many warnings? Five warnings. The first warning was the danger of neglect. The second warning was the danger of unbelief. And we spoke about those. The danger of neglect in chapter 2. The danger of unbelief in chapter 3 and 4. Here in chapter 5, he gives us the third warning, which is the danger of immaturity. Spiritual immaturity. And the diagnosis here, what makes a man spiritually immature? St. Paul said it is the dullness of hearing. Hearing means here understanding, the dullness of understanding. Let's read verse 11 and we'll try to understand the third warning. In verse 11 he said, of whom we have much to say. We have much to say about Christ, but hard to explain. Why it's hard to explain? When there is a subject hard to explain, there are three reasons. Either the material itself is difficult, or the teacher is not eloquent, or the students are not smart. So now the material of whom we have much to say. Actually, whatever St. Paul wants to say about Christ is not difficult to be understood. So the material is not impossible to be understood or to be comprehended. Maybe the teacher? Definitely not, because we have a great eloquent philosopher, St. Paul. So the problem here is not in the teacher, St. Paul, or in the material itself. But why it is hard to explain? St. Paul says, since you have become dull hearing. So we have much to say, but it is hard to explain. Why? Because you have dull hearing. And in the Jewish mind, the word hearing and obeying and understanding are like synonymous. Hearing, obeying, understanding. So, St. Paul is telling them, it is not because you are not smart. It is not because you are not intellectual. That's why you have dull hearing. But you know why you have dull hearing? Because you refuse to obey. You refuse to obey. It is not their intellect for which St. Paul fears, but their disobedience. And St. Paul want to explain them. Obedience leads to understanding. Obedience leads to understanding. Many times our children, especially the youth, come to us telling us, please make me understand first and then I will obey. But many things you have to experience first in order to understand its benefit. For example, if you obey and you start to pray, if you obey and start to confess, if you obeyed and you start to study the Bible, from the experience itself, you will understand why the prayer is important, why studying the Bible is important, why practicing confession is important. This understanding will not come from a lecture about praying, but it will come from your obedience and experiencing it. That's why Job, he told him, by the hearing of the ear I heard about you, but now I have seen you with my eyes. That's understanding through hearing and understanding through experiencing. So St. Paul, he want to tell them, you need to obey, you need to experience in order to understand. Obedience leads to understanding. That's why when we require understanding before obedience, we limit our spiritual growth. When we demand understanding before obedience, we limit our spiritual growth. Let me give an example. If Abraham said to God, make me understand first, why should I offer my son as offering? There is no way to make him understand. But he obeyed God. And this obedience made him spiritually mature. So St. Paul trying to tell them, when it comes to God, obey. As the Lord said to St. Peter during the washing of the feet, you don't understand what I'm doing right now, but you will understand later. Just obey me. Just listen to me. When it comes to God, listen to him. Obey to him. It is not because it contradicts our reason, but because it is higher and above our reason. That's why when we obey, we understand. So, their disobedience led to their spiritual infancy. Their disobedience led to their spiritual infancy. He said in verse 12, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you have been in Christ for so many years, and by now you ought to be teachers. But unfortunately, until now, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God, and you have come to need milk and not solid food. You are still spiritually infants. You are spiritually children. You are spiritually immature. By now, if you obeyed God, you have to be teacher. You ought to be teachers. But why you are not teachers? Why you are still need somebody to teach you the principles, the first principle of the oracles of God? Because of your disobedience. That's why you still need milk and not solid food. And because they are still infant, they lack wisdom and discerning. As he said in verse 13, for everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled, lacking skills, lacking wisdom, unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. So he told them, you are unskilled, you are unexperienced in the word of righteousness. And what does he mean by righteousness? What is right, what's wrong, what's good, and what's evil? So if you obey, you will have this wisdom and you will be able to distinguish between good and evil. And when we are skilled in the word of righteousness, then we will make good choices. He is encouraging them to choose eternal salvation for instead of temporary comfort. So you have now two options: either the eternal salvation or the temporary comfort. Which one are you going to choose? If you are skilled in the righteousness, definitely you will choose the eternal salvation, not the temporary comfort. And what are you going to choose? The painful obedience or the luxury of the world and the road of the least resistance? Which one? Many times we don't want to carry our cross here. We want to go through the wide gate, not the narrow gate. This is not a righteous decision. But if you are skilled in righteousness, then you will choose the painful obedience rather than the road of the least resistance. Then the last verse, verse 14, St. Paul gave us three key words about spiritual maturity, how to be spiritually mature. He said, but solid food belongs to those who are of full age. That is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. As I told you, righteousness, he meant how to discern between good and evil, how to make godly choices. What are these three words? He said, the reason of use, number one, that's the first word. Number two, exercise it, their senses exercise it. And number three, to discern between good and evil. Christian develop a spiritual understanding by the discipline of constant use, by the reason of use. When you train yourself and by constantly hearing the word of God, constantly obeying the word of God, you will develop this wisdom, the understanding. You will not be of dull hearing, but you will understand the depth and the grace of the word of God. So that's number one. That's why sometimes you pray for 1 week and then stop for 10 months. Then you read the Bible for 1 week and you stop for 5 months. This is not the constant use. St. Paul is encouraging us by the reason of use, constant training, constant obeying the word of God. That's the first one. Have their senses exercised. Exercise it through suffering. So many people, they use when there is no suffering. But when there is suffering, they quit. Why I said our senses will be exercised through suffering, I'm linking this with verse 8, when he said about the Lord Jesus Christ, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. So we will have this experience, this wisdom, by what? When we exercise. So through this exercise, through this suffering, we will learn how to obey. And the third word, he said, to discern between good and evil. When we constantly use our senses and obey God and we carry our cross and we endure suffering, the sign of maturity here is the ability to discern between good and evil, to distinguish and make wise choices. This is a sign of spiritual maturity. How do you know if you are spiritually mature or not? Let me examine your choices and your decisions. So you need to train yourself constantly. And when you train yourself constantly, you will develop this wisdom to be able to discern between good and evil. Let me conclude by giving you some questions to think about. The first question, analyze each of the high priest's qualification, and I mentioned six, and identify in what ways the Lord Jesus is superior. How in each one of these 6 points the Lord Jesus Christ was superior. The second question, in what sense did the Lord Jesus learn obedience from what he had suffered? Yeah, I want you to elaborate more about this question, about this verse. Learned obedience from what he suffered. The last question, how does a person become spiritually mature in God's word according to verse 14? What can you do in order to grow in maturity? So these are three questions to think about during this week. In 1 minute, let us review. Answer the questions here. Okay. What is directed toward those who are ignorant and going astray? Compassion. Very good. Through suffering, agony, and temptation of man, he is qualified as a perfect representative. So he became source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. God has designated him high priest in the order of Melchizedek. Learning obedience through suffering as having perfected the Lord Jesus Christ. What expresses the idea? Made perfect expresses the idea of fulfillment. He was not imperfect and became perfect, but made perfect means fulfillment, accomplishment. Third warning, dullness of hearing. The first warning was danger of neglect. Second warning was unbelief. Third warning, danger of immaturity. What leads to understanding? When we demand understanding before obeying, this limits our spiritual growth. Disobedience leads to spiritual infancy. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen. فضل صل. ليترأف الله علينا وليباركنا ليظهر وكاه علينا ويرحمنا. يا رب خلص شعبك، بارك ميراثك، ارعاهم وارفعهم إلى الأبد. ارفع شأن المسيحيين في كل زمان ومكان بإشارة صليبك المحي.
بالسؤالات والطلبات التي ترفعها عنا كل حين، والدتي الإله القديسة الطاهرة مريم، سائر صوف الملائكة والآباء والأنبياء والرسل والمبشرين والإنجيلين والشهداء والنساك والسواح والعباد المجاهدين الذين أرض رب أعمالهم مصلح كل حين. بركة ملاك هذا اليوم، بركة قديس هذا اليوم، بركة رئيس الملك الجليل مخيل وقديس يوحنا المعمدان، بركة سادات الآباء الرسل، بركة ماري مورس كروزنا المصرية والشهيد العظيم ماري جيركس، بركة الأنبا أنطونيوس والأنبا موسى الأسود والأنبا يوانس كاما، وبركة صوم سادات الآباء الرسل، وبركة السيدة العذراء مريم أولا وأخيرا، بركتهم المقدسة ونعمتهم قوتهم ومعاناتهم شفاعتهم وهبتهم تكون معنا جميعا آمين بخريستوس بن نوتي. O King of Peace, grant us your peace, establish for us your peace, and forgive us our sins. For yours is the power, glory, blessing, and majesty forever. Amen. O Lord, make us worthy to pray thankfully. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil one. Christ Jesus our Lord, for thine is kingdom, power, and glory forever and ever. Amen. Now, love of God the Father, the grace of His only begotten Son, our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, communion gift of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Go in peace. May the peace of the Lord be with you all. Amen.